morning on the west coast of the United States and in Hawaii. Good afternoon here on the east coast of North America. Good early evening in Great Britain and Portugal and parts of Africa. And good evening in Western Europe, Finland, Greece. And good evening well into the night wherever you're listening to us in Asia and Australia, which it might be good morning. As you know, this is Fred Plotkin on Fridays. That makes me Fred Plotkin. It's July 24th of 2020. And my really wonderful guest, who I'm so happy is joining me today, is the tenor Gregory Kunde, who is in Rochester in upstate New York. For those of you not familiar with New York geography, I'm in New York City, which is in the southern part of the state. It's on the Atlantic Ocean. And Greg is in the northern part of the state, very close to Canada. Rochester is a beautiful city. It has a very famous music institute, the Eastman School of Music. It is a city full of gardens and flowers and so on. And we'll probably talk about Rochester. First, I want to say welcome, Greg. Thank you for joining me.
My pleasure, Fred. It's great to see you always.
And Greg is originally from Illinois. And how do I describe him to you if you don't know him? He's one of the world's great tenors. I think we can start with that. He won the International Opera Award in 2016, which is like the Oscar of, or the Academy Award of the opera business, as best male singer in the world. And he is a huge star in Europe, one of the most beloved followed stars. His performances sell out. And for reasons that perplex me, and I imagine you, not very well known in his own country. And we don't have to plumb that too much, but I think it's fair to say that. Would you agree or disagree?
Yeah, I would probably say that. I did a lot more singing back in the beginning of my career, but when I went to Europe in the 90s, I sort of got concentrated there and really never really made it back here to the opera house in the United States. Up until maybe a year and year and a half ago, we've started to come back a little bit here. Had a nice opportunity a year ago to sing Samson at the Met, which was really good. But and again, thanks to you for mentioning it all the time that I'm not singing in the United States. I think people kind of got the word that maybe we should do something about that. But I'm not really sure why I'm not well known here, but
this is important. I do want to mention it. Listeners in North America know that there are the Metropolitan Opera broadcast on Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern time. You can hear it anywhere in the world on an app, WQXR.org. That's the classical music station in New York City where I work. And tomorrow, I don't know if you know this, is Your Samson and Delilah from
last year,
the Nita Rockvelishvili as Delilah. I did not know that myself when I invited you for today, but I've since learned that. And therefore, listeners around the world who want to hear Greg's triumphant return, and it was triumphant, to the Metropolitan Opera House, tune in tomorrow at 1 p.m. Eastern time in the United States. So
I may actually do that.
Love it.
Now, is this only on QXR, or is this through the Met streaming?
Through the Met all around the world, if you have the Met on your local radio station, but there are many people who listen to us on IDAGIO who don't necessarily get the Met broadcast on their radio. Therefore, you can listen on the app WQXR.org. So I hadn't planned to, but I'm going to tell a story. In addition to writing about opera and teaching opera, I have been a subscriber to the Metropolitan Opera for 40 years. I used to work there, but even when I worked there, I kept a subscription. And it was a Wednesday night series. And I went last year, I believe it was March 13th, you might know the date. And it was my Wednesday series, and Anita Rockvelishvili and a famous tenor were announced to perform. That tenor
was Anita's debut in the part, isn't that right?
And needless to say, if you don't know the name Anita Rockvelishvili, once you learn how to say it, you never forget, is a magnificent young artist, superstar already in her mid-30s, and you want to know her work. And so I was seated in my seat, and there was a slightly long first intermission, the opera Samson Delilah by Saint-Saëns has three acts. And I just sensed that there might be a tenor replacement. And I had no idea that you were in New York City, and you're going to tell us after how you got to New York City for this event. And the stage manager came out on the stage and said, ladies and gentlemen, the scheduled tenor is unable to continue. The Met typically has a cover who's an understudy, but I don't think that, I know who that person was. That person, clearly they didn't ask him to step on, and they said, and replacing him is Gregory Kunde. And I dropped my program. And because I had seen you the week before in Dallas performing Dallas Opera in Manon Lescaut. Right. And I had no clue that this was in the cards. You keep your cards very close to your chest.
I had no idea either, Fred.
Okay. Well, you'll tell us that stuff. And so it was a stupendous performance, and you were asked to remain for the rest of the run, which is why we have the recording that will be played tomorrow. And because they had to basically walk you through the scenery and show you the blocking, the movement, the intermissions were a bit longer than typical. And although it's not the longest opera, it ended quite late. And I came backstage because, you know, I want to see you and congratulate you. And I wanted to invite you out for dinner because it was all so sudden. And New York used to have a divine nightlife after opera and culture, but the restaurants had all closed by about 12:30. And you and I went to a 24-hour greasy spoon coffee shop that feeds hospital workers at Mount Sinai West. And about 2:30 in the morning, and you had a chef salad and a Pepsi, and I had a tuna melt and an iced coffee to celebrate your...
There you go. Living the life, baby.
So from your side, tell what happens that you suddenly were summoned to New York to appear as Samson and bring down the temple.
It became evident, let's say, that happened in March. Let's say around November before. We were given notice that perhaps we might be called upon to come and be a standby in New York, which I said, well, I'm going to be home in Rochester. If you need me, you can call me, and I'll brush up on the part a little bit. And so I did, you know, just kind of looking through it. And we kept asking more and more as the months went by, will it be happening? Will you be needing him? Not sure. So finally, about a week and a half before this happened, I was finishing up something, and I don't even remember. It's in Dallas. I was finishing up in Dallas and wanted to know if they needed me to come to New York. And I was told by the administration, no, everything's fine. Don't worry about it. And we appreciate you, you know, studying the part and everything, but we won't be needing you. Okay, good. So I went home to Rochester, where my daughter, Isabella, who was 17 at the time, was performing in a musical here at one of the high schools. And we were carting her back and forth and getting her to rehearsals. And it was actually, I had driven her to her rehearsal, and I was going to do a couple of errands before she started. She went to get dressed. So I'm running an errand, and my phone rings, and it says, it was a 212 number. And I thought, who's right? Because it didn't say. So I didn't answer it. I don't answer unless it's in my contacts. I mean, I don't know who it's like. Anyway, so they left a message. So I stopped the car, listened to the message. It's Peter Gelb. Now, Peter Gelb has never called me ever. So I thought it was pretty important. He said, please call me back. So when he said that, I knew what he was going to ask me. And now this was 5 o'clock. The night before the performance. Living in Rochester, there are no flights after 5 o'clock to New York City, unfortunately. If you don't get it by five, you don't get any flights. So I called him back and he said, will you consider coming to New York tonight? And I said, well, I can't do that, but I can do it in the morning and come in the morning at 6 o'clock. That was the first flight out. And, you know, I'm happy to come and do a rehearsal and maybe get a costume fitting. So he said, because we're going to need you. I said, okay. So I got on the 6 o'clock. I got to New York at 8:20 or whatever, went to the hotel, got to the Met, did a costume fitting. And I rehearsed with Maestro Elder, pianist, and the assistant stage director up in a room up in at the Met, just the blocking, just me, waiting for the word that I was going to go on. Anyway, we rehearsed for about 4 hours. And about 4 o'clock, one of the administrators called me and said, everything's fine. We won't be needing you tonight. So go back to your hotel, come to the theater at 7:30 and, you know, sit in the green room just in case, you know, because it's the opening. The opening night, they always have the covers in the green room. So I said, okay. So I went back to my hotel, had something to eat, took a nap, got back to the theater at 7:30. And I was watching the performance in the green room with the pianist. And I'm watching and listening. And this has happened to me many times. I've jumped in this kind of a situation before. And I could hear that I'm going to go on about 15 minutes into the show. So I got a knock on the door and they said, can you get ready? Can you get into a costume? Now, first of all, there was no costume for me. It was the costume that was on the tenor on the stage. So they brought me in and they put me. Yeah, they brought me in and put me in a third act costume. That's all the only one they had. So long story short, I went on for the second act. I saw Anita just before, and we've sung together many times. Now, I had never met anybody, not the chorus, not anybody on the stage. And I'd never set foot on the stage. That's why the intermissions are a little bit longer, so that I could actually walk on the stage and, you know, with those stairs, that stairway.
Greg, I'm just going to clarify, you had never set foot on the set of Samson Delilah. You have been on the set. Yeah,
exactly. So, you know, you want to be able to walk around a little bit before you actually go out there. So anyway, that was the story. And we took a little bit of time in between intermissions so that I could just kind of get familiar with the set. And, you know, that was it. And the duet that you saw that night in the second act was completely ad-lib between the two of us. But I thought it went very well. She's just a magnificent partner. And I wanted to say this about Anita. When I say Renee in opera, you know who I'm talking about.
Renee Popper.
When I say Jonas, you know who I'm talking about. When I say Juan Diego, you know who I'm talking about. Yeah. When I say Anita, you will know who I'm talking about. You don't need her last name. You know it's Anita. That's all you have to know.
Marie, but she is fantastic. Joan, Yuri, Greg. It's true.
You know who they are. Well, Greg, I don't know about that. But, it was a very, very exciting time there. And it was a really nice return to the Met. It was fun.
Yeah. So, you have added substantially not only to my opera going pleasure, but my frequent flyer account. Because you are one of the few artists, frankly, Carita Mottila being another one, for whom I will travel wherever they are to hear whatever they're doing.
Oh, that's so nice. Thank you, Fred.
I go to Seattle next month to hear you in Cav and Pag. And unfortunately, as we know, because of the pandemic, many opera productions around the world, especially in North America, are being canceled or postponed. I got to Dallas because you were performing in Dallas. I've been to Dallas before, but I've heard you now. I toted up in London, in Paris, in Vienna, in Venice, in Bologna, and I'm sure others, but those are the ones that immediately come to mind.
Yeah, so that's a lot. It's more than my wife.
Because, you know, when I publicly speak or write and I say that I think that certain artists belong on our stages more in North America, it's no secret that, you know, someone who sings what you sing, and let's just say it is right now, the core of your repertory is the heroic tenor repertory.
Yeah.
Canio, Samson, Otello, and a number of others, but especially Otello, Radames. Are you still singing Aeneas and Les Troyennes? If asked?
It's curious that you would ask that. I have been asked, yeah, in a couple of years. There's going to be a new production, and I can't say where because it's not announced yet.
Okay,
but yes, I'll be singing in a couple of years.
Yeah,
it's going to be fun. It's with a person that we've just been talking about. So
okay,
anyway, that'll be
understood. I don't name my favorite opera very often because it can change. It can be Don Carlo. It can be La Clemenza di Tito. It could be Fidelio, which I hope to hear you in one day. But typically, Les Troyennes is at the top of the list. And I heard
it's done well. I have to say, if it's done well, it is one of the most magnificent pieces ever written. And but you really have to have, and I'm not talking about me, but I'm not patting myself on the back, but our video that I made, my first one, the first one I did with John Elliott Gardner in the Châtelet, with Susie Graham and Antonacci, Ludovic Tézier, Yanis Kokos production.
Yeah.
It was a very intimate setting. I mean, the Châtelet is, 1,000 seats, maybe 1,200 seats, something like that. And John Elliott brought his own band with original instruments from Berlioz Day. He had the original sax horns off stage. Uh-huh. I've got goosebumps right now just thinking about it, being off stage, listening to those things play. But everybody could really, really sing the part and not... I mean, it's heroic, but it's also Berlioz, which I learned a lot about from John Elliott, in that Berlioz is a contemporary of Rossini. You know, we're talking about the bel canto era there. Mm-hmm. So he did have singers of that era singing this music. It's not Wagner. So when you have lyrical singers singing Berlioz, it's amazing. It can be really, really nice and really beautiful. Probably one of my favorite pieces ever is the duet in the fourth act with Didon.
Nuit d'Ivresse,
it's so beautiful. So beautiful.
And Susan Graham, who is a magnificent Didon, and when she does that role, I've traveled to San Francisco. I've gone to a lot of places to hear her do Didon. Wore a very simple, very beautiful white dress in that production that you were in Paris.
It's gorgeous.
And it required no other costuming. Normally we see caftans and all kinds of elaborate costumes. This simple white dress said everything that one needs to say about the character, the role, her nobility, her purity.
And she was such a magnificent partner. And I love to tell the story because, you know, Susie and I go back a long way. From the mid 80s, you know, when she made her debut, she was my Stefano in the Romeo and Juliet I did with Ruth Ann Swenson in the Detroit. Anyway, I've always done anything I'd done with Susie, she was always in the pants role, you know, she was whatever, Mozart operas, and you know, she was doing pants roles, right? So we get into the rehearsals, we're rehearsing this scene, the duet, right, in Paris. And Yanis and Gareth, we're hugging and we're kissing and stuff. And we get done and the people were around us were going, wow, that judge's gorgeous. So I sat next to her and I said, wow, you play a pretty good girl too. She's like, didn't mean insulting, but I mean, she was really so sexy in that duet. It was amazing. And it's, you know, I just had a different impression of her forever. And, you know, now she's my love interest. It was fantastic. So,
well, you reminded me of Graham's story that she told me directly, because I only tell stories that I've heard directly from the source. She and Renee Fleming were in a production of Armida in Paris, with Renee Fleming playing Armida and Susan Fleming playing a male role, Ruggiero. And basically, Armida is a sorceress. It's from, I'm suddenly forgetting the name of the writer who is from Sorrento in Italy. I will remember in a moment. Tasso, Torquato Tasso, who wrote the story.
Yes. Right.
And Armida basically is someone who enchants men, seduces them, and then freezes them into a tree or another form, but they're frozen and they're like right. victims on the stage. And Robert Carson was the stage director, and I love his work. He's just
the best.
Outstanding.
He's the best.
I want him to
One
be
of
on
the best,
program. Right. He's just, he's everything I want an opera director to be. And when he goes in a direction on a production, even if it seems unorthodox, I'll go with him. And he decided for this production that the scenery, remember it's Paris, should be 50 naked men. In other words, all of the conquests of Armida. And he chose men just who are not all fashion model gorgeous, but all shapes, sizes, ages, and so on.
Yes.
And at a certain point, this forest of naked men just became a backdrop to the production. And Susan Graham was telling me about the rehearsals for this and how at first it was distracting for her and Renee Fleming and Susan Graham playing a man, being surrounded by 50 naked men, but she got used to it during rehearsal. And she said that many of the men who were hired to play the roles were gay. She said, she's from Texas, I always knew which ones were not gay. Because apparently with these two beautiful women on the stage, the gentlemen showed their interest in a
yeah.
most way.
I didn't think you were going to go there, but that was pretty good. Oh my goodness. Yes, sir. Yes. I was going to say that, well, during rehearsals, they weren't naked, but when you,
no, they weren't.
Were you, oh my goodness. Anyway. Okay. So
that brings us back into, I just want to say a little more about Berlioz, and you were mentioning Berlioz and Rossini. I've often said to people, music colleagues, or when I teach, that I believe that each one of us innately, whether it's our blood type, our body composition, our heartbeat, our spirit, our mentality, innately connect to the music of certain composers. And that we just feel that those are our natural rhythms and spirit and personality. And my two are Berlioz and Rossini. And which doesn't mean that I don't love all the other composers, but those two are the ones for which every note makes sense, every chord progression makes sense, the subject matter makes sense, even in Rossini's unusual operas. Berlioz was a great Italianist, he was a classicist. Les Troyennes is the story of the Trojan Wars, but also of reaching Rome and what yeah. Rome represented. He had what was called the Prix de Rome, the Rome Prize, in which he was able to go and immerse himself in Italian culture for 3 years. And so much of what we know about Berlioz was his love for things Italian. Rossini lived in Paris for much of his life, probably knew Berlioz, interacted with him. And the two of them, I believe, after Beethoven, and I would put them up against Wagner and Verdi very easily, wrote better orchestral music for opera, and not just the yeah. overture, but the way the orchestral music comments on, gives color, gives personality and emotions to the issues happening in opera performances. So you who have sung Rossini, you who have sung Berlioz, and you can name any other composer you want, which composers in their orchestral music for the vocal music you sing particularly resonate with you?
I would certainly agree with you with Rossini. If we think about his operas, all of them, and you know, unfortunately in America, we don't know the serious operas as much as we know the comedies. But even the comedies, I mean, Rossini was, he was the inventor of the leitmotif. Well, not inventor, but he used it so much. I mean, he really, you know, you knew who was coming out and themes for different characters that came out. And you know, he would use different themes for different in different characters. But I mean, before Wagner. So anyway, Wagner certainly wasn't the first to use the leitmotif. Anyway, it wasn't called the leitmotif in Rossini's day. It was whatever we call the theme.
Get the motif.
Exactly. But he was so good orchestrating for the voice. I mean, it, typical bel canto. I mean, Donizetti and Bellini the same, but in that way. But I think Rossini's orchestrations were much more colorful. I'm always drawn to him because I always hoped that he was, as a composer, the same way he was after he retired, because he was just a very fun-loving guy, and you know, he got invited to parties, and you know, it seemed that Rossini would never turn down a free meal, and he was always going to parties after he had retired. I mean, the guy retired after he wrote William Tell, and he lived for another, how many more years? 30 years.
Retired at 39, he died at 76.
So, yeah, so, and then he wrote Stabat Mater and the Petite Messe Solennelle at the end. But what a life. I mean, it's just fantastic. And you just, he's the one guy, when I reach the heavenly gates, I want to sit down with Rossini. And I know when I get there, he's going to be sitting next to Zedda, you know, so it'll be tough to separate the two.
Zedda being, there's some we should talk about and recall. Alberto Zedda was a conductor. He died a year or two ago, who really specialized in Rossini. He was based in Pesaro, which is where Rossini was born, though Rossini moved early to Bologna. And he, Zedda, was part of the Rossini revival and did critical editions along with Philip Gossett in Chicago a number of other people. I did one with him. I worked on Il Turco in Italia. And Zedda was just a small man, a wonderful, bright spirit who really knew and loved the music of Rossini, a wonderful conductor. And I think, frankly, that because in many so-called serious opera houses and theaters, Rossini is not taken seriously, or Zedda was not taken seriously. Would you talk about your dealings with Alberto Zedda, who I love very much?
Alberto I have to call him one of my mentors in the bel canto repertory. I did an audition for him back when I was doing William Tell in 1989 in Paris. With Pizzi, in Pizzi's production. Alberto happened to be passing through, and he agreed to hear me in an audition in the Champs-Élysées Theater. And he was, you know, a little man. We used to call him Yoda. God rest his soul. I love him. But that's what he would, you know, he was just a little man, and he just very slight, and does like this all the time. But I got to sing for him, and I sang the William Tell aria, and I also sang Cenerentola, you know, from here to there, you know. And he was somewhat enthusiastic. He gave me some nice comments. He actually said to me, "Your voice is too beautiful to sing Rossini." I said, "What? Is that good or bad? I'm not really sure." But in any case, that was in 89, and I didn't think anything of it. 2 years later, out of the blue, he invited me to come to Pesaro and sing Semiramide. Wow. Now, I had never heard Semiramide in my whole life, but I got the score and learned the whole thing. And I had understood that when you go to Pesaro, they do every note. There's no cuts. So you learn everything, you know. So I got to the first rehearsal and sang through a little bit of the part. And we got to the first aria, Idrino's first aria. And he said, no, everything. He was the conductor. He said, nice cut all the way that we go to the next one. I was like, maestro, wait a minute. I learned it. It's a 10-minute scene. I learned the whole aria. Can we at least, like, through it? Would you mind hearing it? Okay. So the piano starts to play and I start to sing, and it's got like 95 high C's in it, you know, the first 3 minutes. So my wife tells this story because she was sitting next to him when this happened, and he's doing corrections in the score, and I start to sing, and he looked up and he went, and I did the whole thing. and finished, and he said, okay, we put back in. That was it. Okay, I get to sing the whole aria. It was fantastic. But that started the relationship with him. I always felt like he was my father.
Yeah.
He was a little bit older version of my father. And he was like a father to me. I sang so many things with him and learned so much from him. Variations, Rossini style, and I mean, everything that I ever know about Rossini, I learned from him. He was a master. When he conducted, it was like having Rossini in the pit. It was amazing.
He really had not a great technique.
But yeah. I attended his orchestra rehearsals. He was the best teacher ever. He could teach the orchestra how to play this music. And it was amazing. There's a YouTube video of he and I, the last time I actually worked with Alberto. I did William Tell in 2010 in La Coruña in a concert version. And we got to the aria, the big aria at the end, you know, and went really, really well. And we finished the aria and I was over and the crowd just went crazy, you know, it was nice. But I was so overwhelmed. I walked up to him and I just hugged him on the podium. We weren't finished. I mean, we were trying to do the rest of the opera, you know, but we just had a great embrace. And then, you know, I walked up and that's always my biggest memory of Alberto, him just being so supportive of me. And I really loved Alberto. He was right here.
When you say not a great technique, would you explain to our listeners what that means?
Well, it was a little unclear. I mean, when you see somebody like Muti or you see somebody like Abbado or I don't know. I don't even know who he is, some of the great conductors. He was sometimes not very clear, but he was very enthusiastic always. He did a lot of this kind of stuff, which was, it didn't matter because he taught them well. You know, the orchestra knew what he expected. So he was, you know, kind of leading us through. And this, another little story, Before we went on, it was a one performance thing. It was a one-off. Before we went on, we were all standing off stage and Alberto was there in his tux and everything, you know. Now, mind you, William Tell, uncut, 5 hours. Uncut. We're looking at the monitor. He looked at the monitor that you could see the stage. And he said, what is that? What is that on the podium? And the stage manager said, well, it's a chair, maestro. It's a chair. I don't use a chair. Why? You take it away. So we're ready to go out, you know. The concert band, they've already tuned. So the stage manager walks out, picks up the chair, goes back in, pulls the chair out, takes it off stage. And Alberto stood. The first act of William Tell, it's an hour and 40 minutes.
Yeah.
Never sat down. It's unbelievable. And at the time, he was 82 years old. Yep. So, you know,
I remember very specifically when I met him because he was memorable and I loved him from the start. I met him in 1984 because in that era, I worked at the Metropolitan Opera. Before that, I had worked at La Scala, specifically for Giorgio Strehler and Claudio Abbado. And when they were creating the new Rossini Festival in Pesaro, Rossini Opera Festival it's called, the first opera they did was a reconstructed Il Viaggio a Reims, Le Voyage a Reims, that had been lost basically to history. And now it's performed a fair amount. But it was Zedda primarily who did the reconstruction and found different. And for people who don't know it, it's sort of like the European Union set in a health spa.
Exactly. The woman
who runs the spa, which is a funny role. It was played by Katia Ricciarelli and later Montserrat Caballé. And each character who arrives represents a different nation and the music has a different personality. So a Polish woman, a Russian man, a British man played by Samuel Raimi, Ruggero Raimondi. It had an amazing cast. And Abano brought me because he thought, number one, that I would learn, and number two, that I could be of help bilingually and for other reasons. And he Abano presented me to Zed and said, I want you to learn everything you can from this man because it will stay with you for life. And at one point in the future, you'll be able to teach what he taught you to other people. So yeah. Frankly, I had not planned to talk about Zed with you, but I was so happy you mentioned him because he's one of the lesser known, super important people in the opera world.
And I think if you talk to anyone, any artist who has sung any Rossini in the past, and we can go back years, even as far back as Jackie Horn, you know, everybody knew and everybody respected Alberto. And that production of Viaggio Rangs made Pesaro Festival famous. You know, I was in Semiramide 92 when we did Semiramide. It was Semiramide and the Barber of Seville. It's the first time they had done Barber of Seville with Bruce Ford, my brother.
Yeah.
And they brought back all the cast, Sam, Ruggiero, et cetera. I think Montserrat was even there. And Abato conducted
Montserrat replaced, but Montserrat was cast that year instead of Cacciarigirelli, who originated the role.
Exactly. Lella Kuberly sang it a couple of times as well. But yeah, they brought that whole production from, I think it premiered in Pesaro, or was it Pesaro?
Yes.
I think it was. It went to Vienna.
I worked on it.
The Vienna production is, or the film is what you see all the time. So it's from Vienna. But anyway, yeah, made them famous. So,
you famously have evolved, I'll use that word, from the repertory that is bel canto, that is light tenor, let's say, to heroic tenor. You are one of the few and perhaps the only singer who has sung both Rossini's Otello and then Verdi's Otello. And you did it in a short time frame, if I remember.
Yeah.
And I have heard you in the past sing Rossini's, and I've heard you numerous times now with great pleasure sing Verdi's Otello. Talk about the experience vocally, dramatically, what you pulled from Rossini and put into Verdi and so forth.
Very fortunate to have done both. I think there was a guy named, I can't remember his name. Long time ago, in Verdi's day, where he sang both Verdi's both Rossini's Otello and Verdi's Otello.
Pulling your name out, Luigi LeBlanc.
Yeah, I just forgot. Anyway, okay. It was anyway, but he did not sing in the Rossini. He did not sing Otello. He sang Rodrigo.
Yeah.
And is that right? Yeah, Rodrigo is the florid tenor in the Otello Rossini. But anyway, I'm the only one to do it in the same season. As a matter of fact, now I got another record that everybody has to beat. I did it in the same month. So I went from, this is 2015's Scala production that was a reprise of the one that we did in Pesaro with Juan Diego and Olga Peredyatko and me. And so I did that. And then 3 weeks later, I was in Peralada, Spain, doing Verdi's Othello. So that was fun, you know, crazy. Vocally, I have to say, the Rossini Othello is rather dramatic. It's, you know, it's baritenor. It was written for Nozzari, you know, Andrea Nozzari, who's Rossini's favorite, quote unquote, baritenor, meaning there's some low notes, and there's some high notes. I mean, he had a full voiced D above high C, and he could also, you know, shoot out an A flat, you know, low A flat. The Donna del Lago, the role of Rodrigo and Donna del Lago, it's for Nozzari, and this is to say that's the range from low A flat to top D. Not as florid, so that's what makes it different between the baritenor and the lyric tenor that sings the more florid passages. But the range has to be pretty high. In any case, the Rossini Otello was dramatic. As a matter of fact, I have said this many times, the last scene, the duet with Desdemona at the end, is much more dramatic singing than Otello of Verdi in the last scene. It takes up, there's a lot of big orchestration and big singing in the Rossini. What I took from doing Rossini's first to Verdi is the character. He doesn't really change very much. It's based on the same character that Shakespeare wrote, you know, just different librettists. The difference being, when Rossini wrote it, I think it was correct me if I'm wrong, 1816, either 1816 or 1818.
Yeah.
In that time period, it was really forbidden that this character could be with Desdemona, a Moor with a white woman. Could not, the only time you see them together is in conflict moments. Mm-hmm. The first act, when there's a conflict between Rodrigo, Otello, and Desdemona, and the father, you see that conflict. The second act, there's a conflict between Rodrigo and Otello, the big duet, and then Desdemona comes in and tries to break it up. So there's no love interest. And then the last scene where he comes to kill her. So there's no love interest. You don't see them in love at all. You don't see the love that they have. In contrast to Verdi's Otello, where for me, as you're playing Otello, you have the heroic first entrance of Esultate, and then he comes back and he has to stop the fight between Montano and Cassio. And then he has the beautiful bel canto love duet with Desdemona. And you see how in love these two people are. And then you see the progression of the jealousy that happens, which for me is just an amazing road that you have to take from that pure, innocent, beautiful love that the two of them have together. The next act, which now we do always together, act one to act two, you see the jealousy seed planted by Iago in Otello's head. And you see that road that is just full of peril and full of hatred. And you see him go nuts, go crazy, that he actually kills her at the end. And I think that makes him an amazing character, the most amazing character to play. Of course, a difficult singing, but it's fantastic. Yeah. Role, just a role to play. It's fantastic.
I've never thought of John e la notte danza, the love duet, and Desdemona sings Il mio superbo guerriere, as bel canto. That makes sense.
Oh, it is. Absolutely.
I'll have to go back and look at the score now, because I really had never contemplated that very late.
If you really think about it, I mean, yeah, it really sets it up. It really sets everything up with that beautiful, it's sort of like a love duet in Les Tourniens in the fourth act. It sets that fifth act up. You know, the condemnation from Didon when he, you know, she, the whole big scene that she has, but when you have the beauty of the duet with Desdemona and Otello, it sets everything up, because you're so disappointed. You wanted that to go on, and then it's just bad. It gets worse, and she can't do anything. You know, she can't make him understand. It's amazing. Yeah.
You know, during these pandemic times, where a lot of us have more time than we would have preferred, we do different things. And I've come up with a sort of game of, what if the characters had gotten couples therapy? And I was watching Tannhäuser the other day, and I realized that had Tannhäuser and Venus had couples, they really love one another. They got along sexually, romantically. They captured one another's spirit. She was very forgiving. If they just had gone for a couple of sessions of therapy, there would be no more of that opera.
Exactly. Well, this is what happens. If you get couples therapy in Otello, you don't have a third or fourth act. You know, they just we go home after act two. So yeah, we say that about a lot of stuff. Man, they just could have talked it out. It would have been a lot better, you know.
I mean, also the Macbeths, I always feel the Verdi.
That, oh my goodness.
That they just said, okay, we have it good already. Let's not stir the water.
Let's not mess with it. Yeah. Don't mess with it.
I was mentioning the pandemic, and you have been producing some videos and so on. And I didn't know that. And then I spotted one on Facebook, and I was so powerfully moved. And listeners should know that in IDAGIO in Berlin, I have a wonderful engineer every week whose name is Eric. And he's been my silent partner in all this. And I want to acknowledge his good work and to say, Eric, please set up the video that Greg produced. And once it runs, there we go.
We'll see how this goes. I've been having a lot of fun doing these things, and I'm not sure if you're going to play the whole thing announcement, but there was a reason for me making this particular song. I've been doing Sinatra things and a lot of covers of my favorite Sinatra things, but this is
here we go.
This is what I did a couple of weeks ago.
And hello, everyone. We are back with another song, back to the start of a new week here in Rochester, New York, where here in the United States we are suffering through not only the pandemic, but some incredibly difficult times with our population. I don't like to speak too much about it, but we all have to decide that we are brothers and sisters, and we all need more love. And we also, for me, I need to pray about it. And I also need to be a better person. And I'm going to do something a little bit different today. I've been doing Sinatra and a lot of the pop standards and of the 50s and 60s, but this one is really close to me. This is a song that I grew up with also in a really difficult time back when I was growing up, back in the late 60s, early 70s. Same kind of problems we were having at that time. So I'm sure you'll know it. And listen to the words. And hopefully we can get through this one as well. This is not an easy time. So pray together. Love your fellow man. And know that we are all one. When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree that there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see that there will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, yeah, let it be. There will be an answer, let it be. Oh, let it be, let it be, let it be, yeah, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. We'll get through this. Let's be together. Let's be together. Love your fellow man. Mm-hmm.
night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be. Yeah, let it be. Let it be. Love one another. And that's the message for today. Let's get through this, both things. God bless you all.
So, Greg, thank you.
You're welcome.
I responded very viscerally to that video when I saw it. For a number of reasons. Number one, to be perfectly blunt, I was always more a Rolling Stones guy than a Beatles guy.
Hey, come on now.
And I think you're one or the other. And therefore, when these songs were new, I listened to them, but musically, I didn't connect to them as much. And the lyrics, no. I didn't connect to them as much. And it's not saying I disliked the Beatles, but they were just not the Rolling Stones for me, or the Who, for that matter. And but the second thing was, I had never really heard the lyrics to that song as an adult. And my relationship to that song was formed when I was a teenager.
Yeah.
And the wonderful thing about music and poetry and such is we live and grow. And if we pay attention to things for our lives, they take on new and different meanings for us. So in my interpretation of that song, always, let it be, the words let it be meant leave it alone. Whereas when I heard you sing it for the first time ever, they came to me as may it be so.
Exactly.
And in part because you phrased it better than Paul McCartney, but in part because you are, not that Paul McCartney is not a singer and I like him, but your training as a singer who, in this case, you were not singing your own words, you were singing a song the way great singers do, plumbing the meaning of the music and the words, and where you would take a brief pause, where you would accentuate a certain word that I hadn't noticed. For me, it was as if I heard the song for the first time. And because this conversation you and I are having will be on YouTube, people can go back and hear it again and again and again. So, number one, really thank you for that. And number two, what prompted you to pick that song and what did it mean in the context of, we should say, the pandemic, but also there were racial killings and unrest in the United States, or right. Still is, but very yeah. Particularly when you recorded that.
That mostly, I recorded that, I think about maybe a week after the George Floyd incident happened. And I could see, things progressing in a very bad way. And again, as I said in the video, I go back to my experience when I was in high school, when all of that, with Martin Luther King assassination, Bobby Kennedy's assassination, the march in Selma, I remember all of those things. And I remember, and I don't want to get into it too much, but you and I both know that the problems that went on in the 60s and the 70s. And it was not an easy time. And especially growing up in my generation, the generation before me and all those before them, there was a lot of racism that went on in the United States, especially where I grew up, you know, in a smaller town. And I really found that at that time, we fought really hard to not let that be anymore, you know, speaking, let it be. It was not, and I remember going to university in 72, spring of 72, and how different it was, because I was with everybody. I wasn't just with my people from Kankakee, Illinois. I was with people from all over the state. And you could see that you were all there to do the same thing. And it didn't matter what you looked like, didn't matter what color you were. And of course I was in music, and that even was even more for me, the camaraderie between everybody. It didn't matter. And that was so refreshing to me, you know. I didn't have to hear that from my parents and from my grandparents and all those people in that generation. It for us, of course it existed a little bit. You still had people that were not on board with that. But for the most part, it got a lot better, and we could see that. And then when I got into the business, as we call it, I started in 78 at the Lyric Opera. We didn't see color, and it was refreshing. It was just, we were there to make music, and that was so great. And it has always continued like that. You know, when I in Dallas, when we were just doing the mentalist school with Kristen Lewis, you know, I couldn't wait to get backstage and hug her mom. You know, I just love them, you know. And it's disheartening to me to see this happen. And you know, I feel for my colleagues of color, that it's just it hits me here, you know. And
I don't know if
I try to do my part in a little way. It's not very much, but you know, you got to stand by all of this, and it's just really hard to watch. Really, really hard to watch.
I don't know if you saw my conversation a couple of weeks ago with Lawrence Brownlee, the wonderful tenor.
No, I didn't. I'll have to look at that.
We got into this topic somewhat. He is a great leader. And I was looking for the proper terminology, because I found that persons of color is a little too generic and doesn't quite face the problem. And I also said that not every person who's Black is American, and they might be Canadian or British or from the Caribbean or Brazil or any other number of places.
Exactly.
And he properly told me that the term to use is persons of African descent. And I like that. It makes sense now, wherever they are in the world. Greg, when you went into the lyrics of Let It Be, I would love to know your process, if there was one that you're aware of, or whether you were just doing what you are trained to do and have done well for many years, in terms of making those lyrics mean, frankly, so much more to me. I went back and listened to the Beatles. It did not have the same impact as yours did, because of the way you sing beautifully as a singer, but the way you worked with the words.
Well, I appreciate that, Fred. I don't really do, Amy. I don't. These videos are kind of special in that way. Also, you know, even the Sinatra stuff and everything. I try and do everything in one take. You know, if unless I make like a mistake or something, or vocally it doesn't go well, or I go back and I'll start it again. I don't do any editing on them, which is except that I start from the beginning. So it's really about interpretation. And for me, it's like, it's just so refreshing, you know, to be able to interpret something that is meaningful. That's why I chose Let It Be. And because there are not a lot of things that I know that have that kind of a meaning, even though McCartney did not intend it to be what, you know, like, religious or anything like that. Mother Mary is not Mary, Jesus's mother. It's Mother Mary was his mother, as a matter of fact. So, And that takes a completely different meaning, but I interpret it instead of in a more religious way and more, sort of a prayer. I mean, for me, it was a prayer, of hope. And it does, and as you said, it's not let it be, meaning push it aside. Let it be, amen, And I think that's that takes on a different meaning for me in that particular song. So.
Do you think that, I would love to ask Paul McCartney, that when he wrote it and then when he sang it, that the meaning was more of the let it just go to one side, or perhaps
that's a good question. I think, hello. I have a piano behind me. I think as you get older, things do take on different meanings. I think if you asked him what it means to him today, it would be different than what it meant to him back when he wrote it and recorded it. I don't think they had those kinds of big time thought process, lyrics. But I think now it takes on much more meaning. But anyway, I'd have to ask it. So if you ever get a chance, it's about.
But, I'll make a Zoom call with him and you so you can ask him
there
too.
There you go. That'd be great. That'd be fantastic.
As our listeners know, I like to ask my guests to look at the website of IDAGIO and find some music that he or she finds particularly inspiring. And I will say first that if Fritz Wunderlich were alive today, he'd be the interview I want. He has been the most named artist, not just tenor, so far in this series.
And go ahead.
Singing with Christa Ludwig and conducted by Otto Klemper in Mahler's Das Lied von der Erde. Was it Wunderlich? Was it the Mahler? Was it Ludwig, who I adore? What prompted
I,
that?
Well, first of all, when I was asked to sing Das Lied von der Erde, I needed to learn it. So I wanted to listen to a few recordings, and this is the one that really struck me, the joie de vivre that he had in everything that he did, and in such a short life. Can you imagine the career that he could have had if he had lived 20 more years? Can you imagine? I mean, because he did so much in that small amount of time that he was alive. But this one, just every word is just fantastic and just so full of spirit. And that's what drew me. It has always drawn me to Fritz Wunderlich in everything he did. It was one of the first recordings that I know I mentioned the Pavarotti recording as well in one of the other things. But the other recording that drew me was the Fritz Wunderlich greatest hits. Some, he did Mozart and he did Wagner and he did Martha, Ma Paris in German, which is really cool. So that voice, I think when you hear Wunderlich's voice, it's just special, just really a special voice. So yeah, it was Wunderlich that drew me to that. But I mean, of course, the Mahler wanted to learn it, but he gave me a really good example. So.
You are the first person who's mentioned Samuel Barber's Adagio for Strings on your list. What is it? For many Americans, that's a very famous work. He was an American. I believe that Leonard Bernstein conducted it. It's often used in state moments of mourning and recognition.
Yeah, I don't know. I discovered it in university, and it just struck me. Like when whoever listens to this piece strikes you, it's just so, it's really visceral, And we used to. I don't mind telling these stories because when we were in college, we'd get together and we'd listen to music, And when we'd had a few too many, what would we do? We put on Adagio for Strings and we just cry our eyes out. that was the university experience for me. There were a bunch of us, music students, and that was the piece. And it And of course, that recording is the recording that I listened to in college with Bernstein. And so whenever I would hear it, I heard it live a couple of times. It never comes close. You know, you just don't get, you don't have that experience that you had as a kid, you know, you just, but I'm sure it was played beautifully. As a matter of fact, I was fortunate enough. I sang at Carol Fox's funeral. You know, Carol Fox was the lyric opera, right?
Founders of the lyric
opera. She actually requested that I sing for her funeral. When she died in 80, yeah. Artis Krainic said, "Carol, I don't know if you know this, but Carol wanted you to sing at your funeral." Anyway, I sang a couple of pieces, but the string quartet before the service played the Adagio for strings. Didn't have the same effect, but they played it very well. You know, the first chairs from the Lyric Opera Orchestra played in the Adagio for strings, not bad. But that recording still, to this day, you know, it's a magnificent piece of music.
Yeah. You raised an important point here that I think about a lot. And last week I had Danielle Denise and we spoke about it in a different way. For her, one of the really emotional works is Mozart's 23rd Piano Concerto, Kirchhoff 488, the second movement, the Adagio specifically, and how it just reaches her so emotionally. And you were talking about that, the same with The Barber, but do we, when we hear very familiar works, do we recreate our first response or do we hear it differently? I always try to hear something anew and not analyze. One thing when I teach music is I tell people turn off your analytical faculties and open your pores and your nose and your eyes and your ears or close your eyes and just let the music seep in. And then after you will have taken in a lot more and then you can analyze if you wish. And I share Danny's love of the Mozart Piano Concerto 23. And I also share your love of the Adagio for strings. But I try not to listen to certain things for long periods so that when I go back to them, it's more visible.
I have to say, when you ask me those questions, that was one of the first things that came to mind was the Adagio for strings. And I don't know why. I haven't heard it for years. But it's always in the back of my mind. And of course, different interpretations. I couldn't tell you if that was Bernstein or if that was whomever. But I just know that particular piece of music always gives me that response. Even it wasn't the same response in Carol's funeral, but it still it still touches you in the same way. It's just there's something about it.
You also picked very specifically, you picked Mussorgsky's pictures at an exhibition, specifically the Great Gate of Kiev.
Yeah.
So not the chicken in the chicken yard, but the Great Gate of Kiev.
Yeah.
That one.
That, again, I discovered that piece in university. Before I came to the university, Illinois State, I sang in choirs. I didn't have a musical background per se. I didn't really know composers and things like that. I only knew what I sang in choir. So I didn't really know. My musical education started my first year in university. So that was one of the things that was one of the first. You remember the CBS Masterworks where they had the cheapy recordings, you know, that you could buy for at the time $3.99 for an LP of all these.
It would arrive in the mail.
This was LP. Yeah, this was, I think it was on the same recording as Paco Bell Cannon or something like that. There was that series. But that last movement always struck me as, you know, it was just so magnificent. And when I heard it for the first time live, I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. It was just incredible. And it's never gone away. And that last movement, The Great Gate of Kiev, then of course leading up to it as well. But, I actually heard a pianist play it when I was in university, which is the original version, obviously. And didn't have the same effect. He played it really well, but did not have the same effect.
It prompts a thought for me. I was saying before about Berlioz and Rossini and their orchestrations and their particular tone and texture. Just below them for me is Mussorgsky.
Yeah.
And I adore his music. I adore Kovanchina, which is a lesser known of his two operas, Boris Godunov being famous. Is there any of that music that you've explored, whether the song repertory or the operatic repertory?
I haven't. I got a chance to sing Glinka's Ivan Suzanin. I sang with all Russian cast except for me. It was conducted by Eero de Vart back with the Vara Radio Orchestra. This was back in the late 80s, I think it's 89. And that was an incredible time for me too. And learning Russian by, you know, I had no idea what I was saying, but I was, you know, yeah, who's the Russian coach in Dallas? He was there for a long, Alexandra. Anyway, I learned it from him. And I did, you know, it was syllabically, but the Russians were impressed by my diction, and so that was kind of fun. But I really have not really sung any of the Russian music, although I have to say, it's very Italianate to sing in Russian.
Yeah,
it's not as hard as people think it is, but it's
a really lot of Russians sing Italian language. Opera. A lot of Italians, Morello Freni, for example, sang Russian opera. For Linetto,
Nikolai was pounding it into her all the time. I remember that she did her first Onegin in Chicago with Nikolai.
I was there too. I didn't see you.
it was fun.
But
yeah, I was covering Dvorsky at that time.
Okay, the tenor role in Kovanchina is a wonderful part that lies right.
People have asked me, you know,
I'm putting that out there into the operatic universe.
It's like that and the Wagner stuff. And you're going to sing the Wagner. And I'm like, I'm not finished with what I'm doing yet. You know, even as, you know, times are wasting, but I'm really enjoying what I'm doing now. But, well, you know, when you come to my repertoire really late, like I did, I didn't really sing any Verdi or anything like that until I was mid 50s. So I got a lot to do. I still have a lot to
but
explore.
But that actually raises a question that's a pure technical question. Vocal preservation. That there are, Alfredo Krauss was this way. There are certain artists who well into their 60s, Joan Sutherland, Birgit Nielsen, Gregory Kunde, whose vocal longevity, but not just that you're hanging on, but these people were all glorious and you are...
Yeah.
In your repertory, is that just the luck of genetics? Is it the fact that you came late to this repertory?
I was really fortunate again to have been able to have been mentored by Alfredo Krauss. Mm-hmm. And Alfredo was a very, very specific, he had very specific directions for me when I was 25. He said to me, you know, you won't know what your voice can really do until you're 50 years old. Now I was 25 and I'm like, oh my God, what do I do for 25 years? He said, well, you do what you are able to do and no more. Don't push it. Stay where you know you're comfortable and push it a little bit, but not much. Stay where you're comfortable. And he was a great a lesson for me. He never went outside of his repertory, even though I thought he probably could have, but he never did. But that was a big lesson to me. And he said, you won't understand your voice and what it can really do until you're about 50 years old. And for me, it was when I was about 52. And that's when I got I started to sing a little bit more Berlioz. And I sang Damnation of Faust with Charles Dutoit around the world. And we had a great time. I sang the Benvenuto Cellini with John Elliott, and sang Trojans with John Elliott, and got to understand how you expand a little bit more in the bel canto repertory before you go into the other repertory. But never really thought I was going to get there. But I got an offer from Gian Andrea Nozeda, whom you know very well. To sing in 2011, to sing Vespri Siciliani in Torino with him. And that was my first venture into the non-bel canto repertory, even though I really think, you know, early Verdi is still bel canto. And that changed my life, really. And I thought, well, now I can explore a little bit more, and there's still more to do. But it was quite a change for me, repertoire-wise. Vocally, didn't really change because what Alfredo said to me, you won't know what your voice can do until you're 50 years old. What it can really do. And he was absolutely right. For me, it was 52. And I finally found that, we're talking about it in a car thing, I finally found fifth and sixth gear in the voice that I had never used before. So it didn't change vocally anything. It didn't change technique-wise anything. It just, the voice expanded naturally, and I decided that I could use it. So I actually would put out all the sound that I actually had, instead of staying in fourth gear and going maybe 45 miles an hour, or what is that, 70 or 80 kilometers per hour. I actually put it up in the fifth and maybe in the sixth and would use about 95% of the voice, which I had never done before. And it went from being sort of a voice about that big to what we have today. And I didn't really do anything except use everything that I have and didn't change the technique at all.
Greg, you're talking to a non-driver for whom fourth, fifth, and sixth years.
Well, the Ferrari they go up to a lot higher than that. But anyway, yeah, you put it in the last gear.
Is it that the range, the scope existed, but you just hadn't gone there yet?
Yes, and I think that saved me. Yeah. I think it's sort of like. I use it in athletics a lot, and I use the tennis example. You play tennis, or you watch tennis anyway. The younger you are, the more flexibility you have, and you can really hit the ball really hard, and you probably have a 10-year window there where you can really do well, and then it kind of goes down. Well, with the voice, it's sort of the same thing. You can do that. But if you don't want to go down, you save it. You make a crescendo like this instead of like that. Mm-hmm. So you just, and I use the example of people like Krauss and Sutherland and Pavarotti and Domingo and Bergonzi and those, the singers from the 50s, 60s, and 70s who really decided to make a really long career. Alfredo sang until he was 72 years old, and he died 6 months later. But he was still singing The Daughter of the Regiment at age 70. So, and well, and you didn't notice that there was no drop off in the voice at all because he preserved it. He didn't do things that he couldn't do, or that he shouldn't do. Let's put it that way. So when we have younger singers who are attempting big roles at a young age, you can certainly do it, but will you be able to sustain? That is always the question. How do you sustain the career? How do you get to 66 years old and still, be able to sing? You take it easy. You do incrementally increasing your repertoire. Did it take a long time for me? Yeah, probably. You would never say, okay, wait till you're 55 years old to sing your first Verdi opera. That's ridiculous. But there's also that's how I did it.
Yeah, there's also the reality, unfortunately, more than ever, that young artists who graduate from conservatory and might get into a young artist program, they might have student loans to pay in the United States, especially. They might have housing costs, they might have families, that they take roles and jobs because they need it financially, but also they feel it may introduce them to colleagues, conductors, managers who would hire them. And it is a very tough choice.
Sure, and I've known absolutely
who have judiciously said no, but sometimes they had the money to do that.
Yeah. It's a tough business today because, again, 42 years in this business, nobody does 42 years anymore. Me and Tom Hampson, that's it. And for Ferruccio, Ferruccio's even longer. So, and he'll be in another 20 years. Ferruccio just keeps playing golf. And, you know, Tom, same thing. Anybody who plays golf, and Bryn is the same way. And Piotr Bicella, is anybody who plays golf is going to have a long career.
That's Matthew Polenzani.
Matthew Polenzani, see that? And, but, you know, you think about it in a different way. But, you know, unfortunately, we push kids today to do it quickly. And they can do it. There's no question. It's just like the young tennis players. They can do it. But you're going to peter out if you don't take care. You just have to be very, very careful about what you sing. And don't do the big repertory too quickly because, you know, the body's not ready. It's just not ready. What Alfredo said to me when I was 25, it's not that he thought I couldn't do it. He said, the voice doesn't really mature and settle until you're 50. And he was a perfect example, you know?
Yep.
And truthfully, Nicolai and Mirella said to me personally, we were having crises in our 50s, early 50s. And you know who they went to fix it? Alfredo Kraus.
Yeah.
And Mirella had 25 more years after that. What? And so did, and Nicolai sang till he passed away, you know.
I said to Larry Brownlee that the question I most ask is, who's your favorite of the three tenors, Domingo, Pavarotti, or Carreras? And I always answer Alfredo Kraus.
Yeah. The three and a half. There you go. No, I will. The person who's had, there are two people who have had really big influence in my career, and that's Alfredo is number one, certainly. He really encouraged me at the very beginning. I was able to take quote unquote lessons with him when I was a young apprentice at the Lyric Opera back in the late 70s and the early 80s. He was so kind to me and so wonderful. And his wife, Rosa, was, you know, just, and, you know, I know their daughter as well, Rosa Kraus, who is in Madrid. But the other influence was Domingo. Mm-hmm. And Domingo, not personally, but career-wise, watching him and him as a singing actor. And it's what I always hoped that I could be. Because it was, of course, for me, when I was singing bel canto, it was always the tenor who, you know, kind of held the soprano's hand, and you sang a couple of duets, and maybe you had an aria. It was nice. But I was very fortunate to have been able to sing with all of them. I sang with June Anderson, I sang with Edita, and I've sung with Renee, and, you know, the great bel canto singers. I was really fortunate to have been able to sing with them, and still do. It was really fun. But you know, going on, it was just a lot of fun to meld into the new repertory and be able to be an actor. You know, these more verismo parts, I think, requires not only a voice but an act. You know, you have to be an actor. Otello for me is like, I'd sing that the rest of my life. It was just a fantastic piece. And Peter Grimes, the other one. Yeah.
Domingo, also Peter Grimes, fantastic. You live in Rochester, where Anthony Dean Griffey, the wonderful tenor.
Down the road, he lives in Fairport.
Professor at Eastman, and a magnificent Peter Grimes. And if you see him, please say hi for me.
I was his cover in Santa Fe.
Oh, okay.
That's how I met him. That's how I know, I know Tony.
Domingo is also a conductor, and you have taken to conducting. I believe that you began your studies with choral conducting.
I did, yes.
You recently conducted Il Barbiere di Siviglia in Venice. And
so much fun.
I always pay particular attention to singers who conduct because it requires a different approach to the score, both as a conductor, as a singer, then say a singer who does not conduct. Most do not. There are only a few who do.
Yeah.
And when you conduct, what do you bring from the singing world? And when you sing, what do you bring from the conducting world?
I think what the orchestra has said to me is that I always breathe with them. And even with string players, you like to show them that you have to breathe as well. You have to breathe with the singers. And that's very important to me. Wind players are always very happy because I do breathe with them. You know, I take a breath before they have to play. And singers, I feel for them. I know them. You know, I know what they need. And I like to keep the orchestra down. but what I found in all of my reading rehearsals and orchestra rehearsals that I do, you know, it's always, oh my God, here comes a singer. He doesn't know what he's going to be doing. And, you know, when you actually can prove to them that you do know what you're doing, that's like a revelation to them. Oh, then they want to play. They really want to play for you. And I had so much fun in Venice because I had, before I did the barber in the pit, I had sung in 6 productions there and they knew me as a singer. So again, there was that friendliness because I knew a lot of people in the orchestra. So there was that a little bit of, but still you have to prove yourself. Even when you're not a singer, you have to prove yourself as a conductor. And so, you know, when you are able to manage your time in a rehearsal, not do just read through everything and just keep waving your arms and stuff, you actually stop, make corrections. You do sections that you know are troublesome. And when they know you know what you're doing, the respect level goes off the charts. And then they want to play for you, which is good. We had a great time. And had a fantastic cast, too. I mean, we just had a wonderful time. Yeah. And I got to conduct 9 performances and at La Fenice, for heaven's sake. I mean, who gets a chance to do that? It was a dream come true for me.
They were also doing in rehearsal and then performance Semiramide.
Yes, exactly.
I heard the barber performance and Semiramide at the final dress rehearsal.
And I was coaching Enea Scala singing Idreno at the time.
That's right.
You know, all my buddies and Fritza was we were sharing a dressing room, Ricardo Fritza and I.
So, you know, at that final dress rehearsal, I was seated in the back of the auditorium with my dear friend Myra, and at the intermission of the rehearsal, someone came up to me and said, "Maestro wants to see you in his dressing room." And I know Ricardo Fritza, and I didn't let him know that I was there. I don't tell artists in rehearsals that here I am. And I said, "How did you know that I was here?" I was in the back of the auditorium. And he said that when he came in and he stood on the podium and mimed the bow that he would take, he saw me all the way in the back and had it in his head. Fred Plotkin, who loves Semiramide, is in the auditorium. Uh-oh. And obviously,
Fred
I don't...
is in the house.
You know, my friends don't think, they should not think of an uh-oh when I'm present. I'm there to support. And in the case of Rossini, I love it. That's why. I unfortunately need to conclude because...
Oh, no. Running out of time.
But I just wanted to mention one thing. Opera and golf. I wrote an article a number of years ago called Singers and Swingers about the relationship between opera and golf. And it is a very strong relationship because there's something about the walking, the breathing, the patience, the focus, the concentration that singers, all the artists you mentioned are wonderful singers and they all are very passionate about golf. And Ferruccio Fulinetto said to me on several occasions that to get through a period, he was singing in Salzburg, alternating between 2 operas. And on the day in between, he would always play golf just to clear his mind.
That's exactly why I play.
Yeah,
exactly.
And he took commitments.
You're on the golf course for 4.5 hours and it's nothing but tranquility.
Yeah.
It's very quiet. When you walk 18 holes, I played golf this morning. So when you walk 18 holes, you're walking 5.5 to 6 miles and at a nice pace. So it's really, it's fantastic. I really enjoy it. And I've enjoyed it since I was in university. And I know a lot of my other tenor buddies are golfers as well. So
they do.
As well as baritones.
And sopranos.
And basses.
Barbara Bonney.
Yeah. There's just some sopranos out there too. I know Curie played and Barbara Bonney was a golfer as well. And there's all kinds of people out there. Sure.
And there's a friend of mine, Roberto Borgatti, who is a descendant of Giuseppe Valdengo and grew up playing golf and singing opera, and opera as a passionate amateur. He's a golf professional, and he often golfs with singers. And what they do is he'll give a golfing lesson and he'll take a singing lesson. And that's the exchange that happens there. So I will do that with singers and cooking. I'm no good on the golf course, but I'm terrific in the kitchen. And I look
forward. You need that too. That's even probably more important than golf.
Except you don't walk 5 miles and you gain weight. You don't lose weight. But
well, you eat the meal first and then you play golf.
That's right. It has been wonderful having this visit with you, my friend. And I know that you've taught so much, not just to me through the years, but to the people who listen today. And as you say, let it be. And may you continue all the good things you do. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Great to visit with you.